Now available on Tata Sky channel number 526.
Hello and welcome. You're watching Property Hotline with me, Kavita Krishnan, on India's first property channel, Magicbricks Now. Today we are answering tax-related queries with our expert for the day, Asish Sodhani. Asish is an associate international tax practice with Nishith Desai Associates. He joins me in the Mumbai studio. Asish, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Kavita.
We have SS Verma Asish up first, who's written in on email. Now, Mr. Verma says that he's entered into an agreement for a 600 square feet apartment in 1990 in Nalasopara for 2,28,000 rupees. Now, he got its possession in August 2000. He wants to know what is the indexed value at present to define long-term capital gains tax. Now, that's a very interesting question there, and also because, you know, every expert who comes to this show to speak about tax, whenever you come up with long-term capital gains tax, they talk about indexation. Good time now to actually figure out what is the formula for indexation.
Right. So, in case of indexation, so just to give a brief background about what indexation is, so basically the capital gains tax that will be calculated on by multiplying the value of the asset into the indexation cost today, so that you understand what the value of the property is today and then subtract it from your consideration. Now,
what is consideration?
The consideration in this case is the sale price of your property.
Okay, and you said multiply the value of the asset with its price today, right? With
right.
The indexation. So this value of the asset is what you paid for it when you bought it?
Right.
Okay.
So the cost of acquisition of the property needs to be multiplied by the indexation cost and then subtracted from the consideration, which is the sale price of your property.
Okay, so the cost price into indexation minus the sale price.
Right.
Is your long-term capital gains.
Right.
Okay, now how do I get that indexation?
Now, the index cost of acquisition is calculated by multiplying the cost of your house at the time when you bought it with the current index cost, which is calculated. So basically the indexation is available.
Okay, Asish, you're not simplifying this at all. It almost looks like you do not want to give us a simple formula. What do you mean by indexation?
So simply put, indexation means to reach the value of the property, which is at today's value from the time when you bought it 10, 15, 20 years
back. Okay, so this is 2000 is when he got possession. So
right.
He calculates it from 2000, right? Now, today's value he will take as per ready reckoner rates, is that right?
No, so today's value, the Central Board of Direct Taxes provides a list of the indexation that is available to the assessee. So basically, he can take the indexed value in 1990 or whenever he bought the flat, divide it by the year in which he is going to sell the property, and multiply it by today's sale consideration.
Okay, you've completely lost me over there. So just tell me this: I bought the property for 2 lakh rupees in 2000, and say the property is valued at 10 lakh rupees today. That is the market value. It is at 10 lakh rupees.
Right.
How do I get my indexation?
So, the 2 lakh will be multiplied by the indexation cost that the CBDT has provided.
And how do I get this?
So, it's available online. You can simply search for an indexation cost. You get a list. You also get the formula that you can apply and multiply it by 2 lakhs. So, in order for that, your 2 lakhs would suppose become approximately 6 or 7 lakhs. And that you will be subtracting from the 10 lakhs as sale consideration that you will be getting. And your capital gains will be equivalent to 3 lakh rupees.
Right. So that is your simple formula.
Right.
But you have to, you have to adopt a very complicated method to get there. You have to go to the CBDT website and actually get that indexation list, which Asish told you about. Once you get that, then you multiply that with your cost price of the house, what you paid for it when you bought it, and subtract that product from the sale price or the price that you're selling at, and that is your capital gains tax. The easier route would be, of course, to go to a tax consultant. Let's move on. We have a caller. Hello? Hello?
Haan ji, boliye.
Haan ji, aapka naam kya hai aur aap kahan se bol rahi hai?
Main Mumbai se bol rahi hu, Kavita.
Achha, aapka bhi naam Kavita hai?
Haan.
Right. Kavita, bataiye aapka kya sawal hai?
मेरा ये सवाल है, जो हमने प्रॉपर्टी बेची है ना, तो अभी उसके लिए कितना टाइम हम लोग रुक सकते हैं दूसरा प्रॉपर्टी खरीदने के लिए?
आपने प्रॉपर्टी कब बेचा था?
ये मार्च 2015
में आपने प्रॉपर्टी बेचा था, और आप ये जानना चाहती है कितना देर आप इंतजार कर सकती है?
हाँ, क्योंकि अभी टाइम हो गया है ना, अभी देख रहे हैं तो बरोबर प्रॉपर नहीं मिल रही है मेरे को, तो इसके लिए मेरे को टाइम का तो
जी आशीष से पूछते हैं, आशीष कब तक रुक सकते हैं ये दूसरा प्रॉपर्टी में री इन्वेस्ट करने के लिए अपने गेन्स को?
तो इन्हें इनकम टैक्स एक्ट के अंडर में आपको 3 साल मिलते हैं, आप जिस दिन अपनी प्रॉपर्टी को बेचते हैं उससे आपको 3 साल बाद तक चांस है नई प्रॉपर्टी पे पैसे इन्वेस्ट करने का, और अगर आप ऐसा करते हैं तो आपको कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स से एग्जेम्पशन मिलता है।
और 3 साल के अंदर आशीष इनको रेडी प्रॉपर्टी खरीदनी पड़ती है या ये अंडर कंस्ट्रक्शन प्रॉपर्टी में भी इन्वेस्ट कर सकते हैं?
या वो परचेज कर सकते हैं एक रेजिडेंशियल प्रॉपर्टी, या वो एक कंस्ट्रक्टिंग प्रॉपर्टी में इन्वेस्ट कर सकते हैं जो 3 साल में बन जाए। तो अगर वो आज पैसे डालते हैं एक कंस्ट्रक्शन प्रॉपर्टी पे तो वो 3 साल में उनके पास वापस रेडी होके उन्हें मिल जानी चाहिए।
तो कविता, आपको मकान में यानी आपको रेजिडेंशियल प्रॉपर्टी में ही जो है ये पैसों को रीइन्वेस्ट करना पड़ेगा, और आपको आपके पास 3 साल का वक्त है, 3 साल में के अंदर आपको प्रॉपर्टी खरीदनी है। रेडी प्रॉपर्टी अगर आप खरीद सकते हैं तो वो खरीदिए, या फिर अंडर कंस्ट्रक्शन अगर आप ले रहे हैं तो फिर आपको ये इंश्योर करना होगा कि वो 3 साल में उसकी डिलीवरी हो जाए, आपको पोजेशन मिल जाए, ठीक है?
हमने एक शॉप भी बेचा है, वो भी इसके साथ में ज्वाइन कर सकते हैं पैसे ये अपना फ्लैट लेने के लिए?
आशीष, कैन दे कंबाइन टू प्रॉपर्टीज एंड सेव कैप ऑफसेट द कैपिटल गेन्स ऑन दैट बाय इन्वेस्टिंग इन वन प्रॉपर्टी?
नो, सो हाउ द इनकम टैक्स एक्ट वर्क्स इज दैट फॉर रेसिडेंशियल प्रॉपर्टी यू विल गेट अ बेनिफिट इन केस यू आर ओनली परचेजिंग अ रेसिडेंशियल प्रॉपर्टी। अगर आप एक शॉप को भी साथ में लेते हैं तो उसका कैपिटल गेन्स गैस अलग से आपको कैलकुलेट करना पड़ेगा।
और ये जो शॉप का जो कैपिटल गेन्स है, where does she need to reinvest that? Can she reinvest it in a shop or should it be in a residential property?
अगर वो उसे 3 साल के अंदर में एक residential property के अंदर में करते हैं तो भी उनको benefit मिल सकता है capital gains tax exemption का।
लेकिन वो अलग से उनको calculate करना होगा।
जी, but एक और चीज़, एक आदमी के अंडर में एक ही रेसिडेंशियल प्रॉपर्टी इन्वेस्ट कर सकते हैं। अगर आप सेकेंड रेसिडेंशियल प्रॉपर्टी लेना चाहेंगे तो आपको वो बेनिफिट ऑफ कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स नहीं मिलेगा।
जी, तो कविता, एक आदमी जो है, एक इंडिविजुअल जो है, वो एक ही प्रॉपर्टी का कैपिटल गेन्स का जो डिडक्शन है वो क्लेम कर सकता है दूसरे प्रॉपर्टी में रीइन्वेस्ट करके। अगर आपका दूसरा दुकान भी है तो किसी और के नाम पर आइडियली आपको रीइन्वेस्ट करना पड़ेगा।
okay,
और इसका इन्वेस्टमेंट आपको अलग से करना पड़ेगा, ठीक है? थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर कॉलिंग इन। मूविंग ऑन, वी हैव नारायण प्रसाद हूज कॉल्ड अस। नारायण, टेल अस व्हाट्स योर क्वेश्चन।
Good evening, sir. See, we have located a property that is flat in Pune.
Okay.
The builder says the OC of the flat is received, but CC, that is completion certificate, is not yet received, as the amenities like swimming pool, etc., yet to be developed.
Okay.
Now, my question is, where in such cases where OC is received, whether builder can charge, number one, service tax, number two, VAT.
Okay. Does he need to pay service tax and VAT if they have got the OC for the property, but they have not yet got the CC, that is the completion certificate?
So, let's quickly understand what a CC is and what an OC is. A completion certificate is given when the building or the locality or the society is ready as per the building plan that has been submitted. An occupation certificate, OC, is given when the house becomes livable. That means with respect to electricity, water, all of those other small details have also been finalized, then the civic bodies will issue an OC. Now, the fact that you have received an OC...
So, the CC comes after the OC, is what you're saying?
Usually, yes, but...
And this is separate from the CC that comes at the beginning of the project, which is a commencement certificate. Now, that is also called the CC, but that gives you the permission to start building. This is a certificate which says that building is complete, construction is complete. Go on, Ashish.
That's right. So, usually, Kavita, a CC would be followed by the OC, but in this specific case, since the swimming pool and other amenities are still being prepared, therefore, the OC has been issued because the house, the flat has become livable. There he can occupy the flat. So, in such a case, since the OC has been given, there is no liability to pay service tax. This is because service tax is levied only in cases where a service is being rendered. In this case, a ready property is being given to him, and therefore there is not going to be any service tax issue. Similarly for VAT, there is no VAT on sale of immovable property. Only if it would have been an under construction property would there have been
but
a VAT
this
implication.
Then would be a function of when Narayan bought the property, right? Whether he bought it at the under construction stage or whether he bought it after the OC was granted.
Absolutely.
So Narayan, when did you buy this property?
No, we are going to buy the flat. The flat is already livable and the OC is received. Hmm. But the builder is insisting that you have to pay the service tax and VAT, even though the building has been already given the OC.
So
I have yet to purchase. It is already completed and I have yet to purchase.
So technically you don't need to pay the service tax and VAT is what Ashish says. Now Ashish, is there a remedy over here? Is there something that Narayan can do if he does want to go ahead with the purchase?
So I'd suggest that you can sit with some consultant and bring the builder to the consultant or get the consultant to the builder and then have a chat over why there should not be a service tax or VAT implication in this case.
And Narayan, also you should probably just seize the opportunity and sit down and negotiate with the builder, because it's also a buyer's market, and what he's asking you over here is clearly he's clearly in the wrong, and you're well within your rights not to pay this. You should actually sit and tell him that you are not supposed to be asking me to pay this, and go ahead with the purchase, but do not pay the service tax or the VAT because you don't need to pay that. Moving on, we have Prafulla Kumar, who sent in a question. He says that he bought a villa of 180 square yards in a gated community of 150 villas in Hyderabad. Now, Ashish, he says that it has amenities like a swimming pool, clubhouse, etc., scheduled to be completed in May or June 2016. He wants to know if he has to pay service tax and VAT on it. If yes, in what percentage of buying? We just heard this answer, but Ashish, go on.
So, as I said, service tax is payable only in case a service is being provided. Therefore, in this case, since a service is being provided, service tax would be applicable. But the question then comes is, how much will service tax be payable? So, the value of the land plus the services provided is a total value for what you are paying. But there is no service tax on the value of land, and only the value of the service that is being provided should be taxable for service tax. Now, if the two cannot be distinguished, if the two values cannot be separated, then the government has provided for an abatement scheme wherein 75% of the total invoice value is considered to be for the land and the 25% is considered for the service, in which case you are going to pay service tax for the 25%. So the effective rate therefore from 14.5 becomes to 3.625% on the total invoice value.
Okay. So essentially, you need to pay around 3.625% as service tax. And what about VAT?
VAT in this case would be applicable, and it would depend on the state in which the flat is being purchased.
But the service tax is the same across the country because it's levied by the central government.
Right.
Okay. Ashish, next question comes from SJK Murthy. He's written in through email. He says that he's 67 years old, wants to sell a vacant site to a buyer. Now, the buyer wanted to make a sale agreement with a forfeiture clause. Okay, so that's something that you'll need to explain to us. What's the forfeiture clause? He's paying advance amount by check. He says that he will get the property registered before April 2016. How safe is the agreement of sale if the buyer doesn't get the property registered by paying full amount on time? He says that the court then may not honor the case in his favor because of the forfeiture clause. He's worried now that such an agreement is tilted in the buyer's favor, and what happens, he says, if a legal problem comes up. My understanding, Mr. Murthy says, is that this agreement is valid for 3 years only. Please advise, I don't want to take any chances. What would you say? That's quite a complicated question over there.
Right. And I think more from a legal perspective. Very quickly, a forfeiture clause basically is a clause where if a part of the duty is not performed by either party, then there is a chance for the party who is not defaulted to take back that property or to not give the money in case the seller.
So what you're saying is, if I'm the buyer and there is somebody who's buying property from me and say he's supposed to pay me X amount by so and so date and he doesn't do that, then he forfeits any right to the property. Is that what you're saying?
Something like that.
Okay. Okay.
Right. So in his question, so there is something called part performance under the under Section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act.
Okay.
Now, under that provision, the buyer is supposed to carry out his part of the contract.
Hmm.
Now, in case the buyer is not carrying out his part of the contract, then the seller has the right to not complete whatever he is obligated to do under the contract. So in this case, even if Mr. Murthy thinks that, you know, there is something that the buyer may not be able to do or may not perform his part of the contract, then he has a valid title to go and fight for his property.
In fact, if I go by what you're saying, Ashish, this agreement seems more in Mr. Murthy's favor, that is the seller's favor over here, rather than the buyer. Because here, Mr. Murthy is well within his rights to take back the property if the buyer doesn't pay on time.
Absolutely.
So he's actually safeguarding himself by putting in that forfeiture clause.
Absolutely.
But what he also said something about a three-year time period, three-year validity. What is that?
So I think on the three-year validity, he must be saying that the agreement is being entered into for the termination of the agreement for 3 years, something like that, maybe.
Okay. So essentially what you're saying is there is no problem with this agreement, and if you insert a forfeiture clause, it actually in this case is going in the favor of the seller, which is Mr. Murthy. So Mr. Murthy, you should rest assured, you protected yourself very well by putting in that forfeiture clause. Let's move on. Muthuswami Chandran has called in. Mr. Chandran, tell us what's your question.
Yeah, good evening. This is Muthuswami Chandran here. I have a question. Can I buy a property on a capital gain if I hold a couple of residential property already in my name?
You already hold some residential properties and you want to buy a property to reinvest your capital gains. Is that right?
I am planning to sell off one of my residential property. Probably I will be getting a capital gain. Can I reinvest the capital gain in another residential property?
Will he get the benefit?
I'm already holding a couple of other properties also in my name.
Right, Chandran. So basically, he wants to ask whether he'll get the benefit of the deduction by if he invests in another property.
Right. So, Mr. Chandran, as I think I also pointed out earlier in the show, that you know the Income Tax Act provides for benefits only in case you have one residential property. Now, the moment you have more than one residential property, the benefit that you are getting, that is the capital gains tax being exempt, goes away. So in your case, since you already have a residential property and now are going to get another one, the benefit of capital gains tax will not be available to you and you will have to pay capital gains tax on the difference of the consideration and the cost of acquisition.
Right. So Chandran, you will have to pay the capital gains tax over there. Ketan now calls in, joins us on the phone. Ketan, tell us what's your question. Okay, I think there's a problem with Ketan's call. We will get back to him, however. We have Rachna who's called in. Rachna, tell us what's your question.
Hello, ma'am. Mera question hai, agar main mera property bechu aur wohi mera ek hi source of income hai. Aur koi source of income nahi hai, tab bhi mujhe kya capital gain tax dena padega?
Agar inka ek hi source of income hai, wo matlab wo usi property se aa raha hai, Ashish, तो क्या इनको कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स देना पड़ेगा?
हाँ जी, उनको कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स देना पड़ेगा. कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स डिफरेंशिएट नहीं करता है बिटवीन फ्रॉम द सोर्स ऑफ इनकम. इसलिए अगर आप वो प्रॉपर्टी को सेल करते हैं, बट अगर आप उसको री इन्वेस्ट कर देते हैं एक दूसरे प्रॉपर्टी में 3 साल के अंदर में, तो आपको कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स से एग्जेम्पशन मिल जाएगा.
आशीष, रचना जी को ये भी बताइए कि जो मान लीजिए वो प्रॉपर्टी आज बेच रही है और 3 साल के अंदर आप जैसे कह रहे हैं उनको दूसरा प्रॉपर्टी खरीदना, तब तक उन पैसों का वो क्या करे? क्या उन पैसों पर उनको इनकम टैक्स देना पड़ेगा या टैक्स बच सकता है किसी तरह?
हाँ जी, तो एक तरीका है कि वो कुछ बॉन्ड्स खरीद सकते हैं. लॉन्ग टर्म बॉन्ड्स हैं, इनकम टैक्स एक्ट में प्रोवाइडेड हैं. 50 लाख रुपीज़ तक वो उन सब का बॉन्ड खरीद सकते हैं उसका. द रिमेनिंग अमाउंट ऑफ मनी जो 50 लाख के ऊपर बचते हैं, वो अपने बुक्स में वो दिखा सकते हैं कि इट इज़ केप्ट एज कैपिटल गेन्स मनी, एंड वो विद इन 3 ईयर्स उनको वापस री इन्वेस्ट कर सकते हैं. उनको कोई ज़रूरत नहीं है कि वो उस पर टैक्स पे करें.
तो रचना, कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स आपको देना ही पड़ेगा अगर आप प्रॉपर्टी बेचती है, लेकिन आप ये टैक्स देने से बच भी सकती है अगर आप इसे तुरंत किसी दूसरे प्रॉपर्टी में री इन्वेस्ट करें 3 साल के अंदर अंदर, या फिर कैपिटल गेन बॉन्ड में आप 3 साल तक इसे लॉक इन कर सकती है, लेकिन सिर्फ 50 लाख रुपए आप ऐसे इन्वेस्ट कर सकते हैं. मूविंग ऑन, वी हैव ऑलविन हुज कॉल्ड इन. ऑलविन, गो ऑन, टेल अस व्हाट्स योर क्वेश्चन.
या गुड इवनिंग, माय क्वेश्चन इज, व्हेन आई बाय अ न्यू फ्लैट
say, for example, over 1 crore, is the buyer who is an NRI liable to pay withholding tax under Section 194-1A of the Income Tax Act at the rate of 1%? Because recently I read in one of the newspapers that that the recently introduced withholding tax requires the buyer to deduct tax at the rate of 1% while making a payment to the seller who is a resident of India. In bracket, it is mentioned who is a resident of India for a movable property other than agricultural land. So, if but there is no such.
So, Alvin, tell us this: are you the NRI over here, or are you buying from an NRI?
No. I am not. I am an NRI who is buying a new property.
New property. Okay. And you want to know whether you have to pay withholding tax on this?
Withholding tax, whether an NRI is applicable.
Right. Ashish, does he have to pay withholding tax? He's an NRI buying property.
Yes, he has to pay withholding tax. So, as Alvin was saying, that the provision provides that you need to be a you need to be paying to a resident, and the fact that you are paying to a resident means that the 1% would be applicable to you. It does not, the buyer is not distinguished under the provision, so therefore you could be a non-resident Indian or even a resident Indian who has to make the payment, and therefore TDS would then become applicable.
Okay, so whether you're an NRI or whether you're a resident Indian, if you're buying property from an Indian, you have to pay 1% withholding tax over here. Okay, Alvin, does that answer your question?
Yeah. Thanks a lot. Thanks.
Thank you very much for calling in. With that, it's a wrap on this edition of Property Hotline. Ashish Sodhani, thank you very much for coming in. Hope to see more of you in future. We will have a lot of these questions coming in.
Thanks, Kavita.
If you have any feedback or suggestions that you would like to share, if you have any questions that you want to ask, do get in touch with us through email, through Facebook, on our website www.mbnow.in. You can tweet to me. I'd love to hear from you. Or just call in live like all the other callers you saw on the show. Thank you for watching Property Hotline. Keep watching Magicbricks Now.